Today, me and Rafaela will be talking about a subject which interests us, and that's the concept of a service mesh, and what a service mesh can actually do for your microservice architecture. And so for those of you who do not know me, my name is Jeroen Rijn, and I work as a software architect at Luminous. And I really like to work with complex systems, so distributed systems, amongst others, sometimes in cloud environments or on local, on-premise clouds. And I like the concept of a DevOps culture, so everybody's involved, everybody has the same goal where you want to achieve something valuable for your customer. And today I will be giving this presentation together with Rafaela.
Hi, so my name is Rafaela. I'm a Java developer at Luminous Amsterdam. I like to solve problems with creative solutions, although I also like to use existing solutions for your problems. I like to travel, I like to take pictures, and I like to combine those two things. So.
Okay, so now you know something about us. But now we also like to know something about you, and this will give us some context, and so sometimes we can perhaps elaborate on some certain aspects that or topics that we'll discuss. So this talk is about microservices and service meshes, and to get a general sense of feeling, please raise your hand if you're actually running a microservice architecture. Okay, so that's about half of the people, that's good. Are you running this on Kubernetes? That's a little bit less. In the cloud, maybe? Oh, that's similar, cool. So I guess all the other people are running a monolith? Okay, that's good. So it gives us some context on what we can discuss and why we're doing this. And so now you're also at the conference, and usually I'm on the other side, so I sit in one of those chairs and I watch the speaker talk about a certain topic. And over the last year or so, I went to a couple of conferences, and the term that I heard quite often, actually, and sometimes wrapped in a different presentation, was the concept of a service mesh. And then different conference, again, service mesh, and a different conference or a different talk, again, service mesh. And I was like, okay, apparently this is very interesting, so I should take a look at what's going on there, and why this topic of a service mesh is interesting. Who here has heard about a service mesh before? Okay, that's good, so that's half. Anybody running a service mesh in production, just to give me some context? Okay, that's good. Well, I see one person there, I know this guy. So. Yeah. And okay, so that's good, so then we have something to share. And but for me, as like a non-native English speaker, I first struggled with this term, like, what's a mesh? What does a mesh do? So I looked it up at the Oxford Dictionary, and it says, well, a mesh is like a computer network in which each computer or process in that sense is connected to another process or a number of other processes. Still a bit vague, right? I didn't really explain what it was doing. So I tried to figure out what this concept of a service mesh is, because I just saw some fancy demos and people showing off user interfaces and command line interfaces. So I Googled a bit further, and on Google I found that it's actually related, or the term probably comes from the different network topologies that we have. So when I was in, I think that's middle school, if you would translate that, we had this computer club at school, and all the computers were actually connected to each other and they formed a ring, so you have a ring network. And mesh is just a different topology, and also have topologies like a bus, which you probably also know. A lot of people who have been building applications probably had to work with enterprise service buses, amongst others, where you plug in several backend services. So, but if we focus on the mesh topology by itself, we can actually see that each node in this mesh could be connected to another node or could be connected to multiple nodes. So there's some sort of like a network, and you could have like a partial mesh where some of the services are connected to some of the other services, or you could actually have like a full mesh where every service is connected to every other service. Well, I've not seen this in practice, at least not in software development. It could be on a network layer. But Well, then we sort of know where the term mesh comes from and what it says. But what is actually a service mesh and what problem does it solve?
Yeah, so, well, of course, we Googled the term service mesh and, well, we found out that actually a service mesh is an extra infrastructure layer you have to add to your services, and it will handle the service-to-service communication of your services. But then we were wondering, why should we add such an extra layer to our architecture? Why are we going to do that? So let's go back to our microservices structure. So we have our microservices, and they are distributed, like a distributed system. And, well, they are communicating with each other, and they are communicating over the network. And, well, we all know communication is hard, so there's a lot going on. And, well, of course, we want reliable communication within these microservices. And that is even more complex, because we need to be sure that everything is working fine. So, of course, we can try to figure this out ourselves, how we are going to ensure that communication is reliable. But we can also take a look at the history and take a look at, like, 50 years ago, how computers were communicating with each other. So let's just imagine, this is really a simplified overview, that we have two computers and they needed to communicate to each other. And, well, both of those computers had their own services with some business logic and, well, they were connected to each other. And, now, there was a networking stack as well, so a lot of cables and things. And, well, we were sending packets from over the network from one service to the other service. But you can imagine when you are trying to send a lot of packets to the other service, to the over the network could be overloaded. So at that time, they decided to create logic to control the flow of sending those packets over the network. And first, they decided to do this in the services themselves, because that's the most easy way, right? Just adding some extra code into your services. But at the time being, they were thinking, couldn't we just standardize this with some specific things? So this is what just happened. They decided to create TCP and IP, and those are all standards that solve specific network problems for us in a generic way, so that our services will not contain that logic anymore, but it is now in our networking stack.
Oh, that's interesting. So we just moved some of our code away from our own application into a more generic layer. So now if we fast forward this a little bit, because this is like decades, way before I was born, still interesting. But if we look at more at the more recent situation, we have different problems to solve. So we have a bunch of services, and when you have services communicating with each other, you will run into certain aspects that you really need to be aware of. So Peter Deutsch at Sun Microsystems actually came up with this list of 8 fallacies of distributed computing, so 8 assumptions that you actually shouldn't assume, but could always be wrong or are in fact wrong. So one of those could be, and especially if you look at the, modern environments like cloud environments, one of the assumptions could be that your network is always reliable. I guess we all know that networks can fail, computers can fail, so we need in our applications to be aware of those aspects. Same goes for latency. If you're going across the wire, if you cross geo regions, you will have latency that you really need to think about. So there are several aspects within our services that we're creating that we really need to be aware of when we make a transition towards a microservice architecture or a service-oriented architecture. So some of these critical functions in microservices, and this is, I think, especially interesting for the people who are not running a microservice architecture, is that you have to look at certain aspects. So, for instance, you have a whole bunch of services, you have multiple instances of those versions running, And you want to do proper routing. So you need to know where, for instance, when you communicate from service A to service B, you need to know where service B is. If you have multiple instances of service B, you need to have some sort of service discovery. So it needs to be a service registry somewhere which tells you I have these instances of a specific service. You can find them on these locations on the network in case you want to communicate with them. Same goes for resilience. So like we said, the network can be unreliable. Service can be slow. So we need to building something in our service which will prevent us from having problems when another service is not behaving properly. And when you try to figure out which service is not behaving properly, you will have to do something about observability. So this could be metrics, it could be tracing or logging. And then sometimes you also want to make sure that not every service is able to access your specific service. So you might want to do something about security on the service itself, or on the network between the services. So I briefly already touched upon multiple services, multiple microservices, scaling microservices, which of course is one of the strengths of having a microservice architecture or going the microservice route. But it brings some complexity when it comes to where are the services located, how many instances do I have. So we have this concept of service discovery and service registry. Just to illustrate this a little bit, to give some context. In this case, we have four different services. They all have their own X amount of instances. And to be able to communicate between those services, we will need to do something. So in this case, all the services will register themselves with the service registry. So the service registry contains this list of all the available services. Now, if I want to, for instance, communicate from service A to service C, the first thing I would do as service A is ask the service registry for the information on where all the service instances of service C, for instance, are. And then when I actually get this list, I can decide on sending the traffic, either load balanced or direct traffic, to this service C. So this is one of the aspects that you have to think about when you're doing microservice architecture and you want to discover where the other services are. Dynamically, because you can scale them up, you can scale them down, so there could be multiple. So this will change. Another aspect is resilience. So usually, when I was a young programmer, my first assumption would always be, well, I'll just call this backend service and it will always be there. You know, everybody says I have this 99.9999 something uptime, so it should be there and it will always behave. But as I learned, well, just network reliability is not the first assumption that you should be worried about. The service could also just misbehave, could throw errors, it might be something wrong. Everybody is working on code these days, they can make mistakes. You push it out to production, you hope it won't reach production in the wrong state, but it could. So you want to think about these things. Same goes for latency, and same goes for if the server is overloaded. Some of the requests might drop, so you'll need to do something about that. So when we started building, if we take a couple of years back, when we started building these distributed applications, this pattern evolved. I want to mention this as well with regards to resilience. So if you just have two services talking to each other, so you have service A and service B, then you have only one concern. But what if you have this entire cold chain of services? What if the last service in your chain fails? What happens then? You might say, well, then it fails. But it will also mean that, let's say service 4 is slow, service 3 will become slower as well, because it's waiting for service 4. And you will get this complete cascading failure throughout your entire chain. So there's this pattern that actually emerged on top of that, which is called the circuit breaker pattern. And the circuit breaker pattern actually says, when I, as a service, and I'm a client, and I connect to a remote service, I want to have some intermediate layer, which is called a proxy or a wrapper, that functions actually in a similar way as an electronic circuit breaker. And for those of you who don't know this, I have this very little diagram where I can show this. So if the service communication is flowing properly, so you can communicate from service A to service B, the electronic circuit will be closed. Just like if you plug a wire into your electricity at home, electricity will flow. And if you want to turn off the lights, you might swipe a switch and then the communication is stopped. So it also for our service-to-service communication, if something goes wrong and our backend service is failing, we actually open the circuit, so there's no direct flow of communication. And what we then want to do is once in a while figure out if the service is behaving properly again. So we try after a certain timeout. And if it's behaving, then we'll be in a half open state, so it will try to send some of the requests through and some of the others it won't. When it's still not working, we'll just go again back into the open state, but if it's working fine, we'll just close the circuit and all the communication will be flowing between the services. One other very important aspect, like if you have cascading failures or if you're failing services, you want to figure out which service is causing the problem. So you have this triangle of monitoring, and so you want to have proper logging, you want to have proper metrics about your services, and you want to have proper traces. So I'm not going to talk a lot about these traces and tracing between microservices. If you really want to see that, Rafaela did a really nice presentation about that last year of using Zipkin, amongst others. But tracing really helps you, like, to say, if I have a communication flow from service A to service D, I can want to see each and every single service that it has touched and want to get the information from those services while it's doing the entire chain. So the latency, the start and end times, and so on. And of course, one of the last aspects I already touched a little bit about is security. So you could, for instance, when you have microservices communicating with each other, or services in general, you want to have something like permissions, or you want to use tokens to figure out within your service if somebody is actually able to access the information from your service. But also on the network layer, you might want to think about securing the actual layer itself, so nobody can snoop in on the traffic that is flowing between these services.
So, well, we have all these kind of cross-cutting functions we would like to add to our microservices. And, well, we can, of course, just say, okay, we are going to add each functionality just inside each of those services as extra logic. But, of course, we can wonder if we have a lot of microservices over there, we want some generic way to add all this logic. So we want something that makes it more easy to just add it in each of our microservices. And this is where actually the libraries became available. So there are different libraries for the different functionalities. And several large companies such as Netflix and Spring and Twitter just developed specific libraries for specific functionality like circuit breaking, observability, load balancing. And you can just use these libraries, of course, dependent on what stack you are using. And yeah, you can just use that in your microservice architecture to enable these functionalities. But of course, when you are trying to add those libraries into your stack, you can you sometimes will have to really know what the library is actually doing. And because you didn't develop the library, well, you have to know what it's actually implementing into your application. And maybe there are dependencies on which framework you are using or which language you are using. And if you are using other frameworks or languages, then you cannot use the library anymore. And then you have to find out something equal or you cannot use it in that microservice. Also, when a library is upgraded, well, you need to upgrade that also in your microservices. But how are you going to do that? Are you going to upgrade them all at once? Or are you going to upgrade some of them and then the rest? Is it backwards compatible? Well, these are all things you have to consider when you are going to add such a library. And also when you have multiple teams and you are going to create another microservice, are you sure that the team knows that the library exists so that they can just add it to the new microservice? So we can have all these libraries inside our services, but is this what we want? Do we really want this business logic inside this logic inside our services?
That's a very good question, Rafaela. And I've been thinking about this as well, because this is one of the things that I've come across, and it's sort of like a similar evolution that we saw with the network stack, is that we see some common functionality that we pull out of our application logic, move it into either a different layer or move it into a reusable component. And so now we have these libraries, but still they're stack dependent, language dependent. So is there a place somewhere where we could actually pull these functionalities out to? And these days there actually is, and that's a, I think that's an interesting development. Especially, I work right now on a project which has a lot of microservices, and we have to implement and think about all these cross-cutting concerns on a daily basis. But I also wondered, like, why are we doing this over and over and over and over again? So could there be a place where we could, like, move this logic and functionality to? So one of these solutions, for instance, could be a proxy. And a proxy is usually already probably on your network, and it handles network traffic, and it handles concerns like, can I go to a certain service? Where do I do routing and sometimes even load balancing? So proxies are an interesting aspect. And if you look at, for instance, like the OC model, where we said like the same thing that we did on the network stack, we just looked at, okay, are these functionalities cross-cutting concerns? Should they really be on the layer level, so in our application level, or can we move them to a lower level? And with proxies, we actually can. So if we look at this evolution, we will need to search for proxies that actually provide these cross-cutting concerns for us. And these days, there actually are multiple, because some other, well, more bigger companies have been actually been looking at where to move these functionalities to.
Yeah. So, and, but at the moment that we are moving that functionality from our applications to proxies, this also means when you are not having any DevOps teams, that there will be a shift from the development team to the platform team. So instead of the responsibility of the development team on how you are going to provide the circuit breakers and the load balancing, this will all be passed to the platform team. So they should be aware what actually needs to be done to get all your microservices with that functionality. But, well, let's consider that we have all those proxies available next to our microservices. So these are all microservices with proxies. And these proxies are connected to each other. And at the moment, as you have a lot of microservices and proxies, they will all be connected to each other. And this is where actually one of the first meshes will be created. And, well, the first generation of a service mesh actually consisted like this way. So you have an environment and you have your services running over there, some of the services, and they are connected to a proxy. And this proxy is connected to another proxy in another environment, and this environment also has other services available. So this is how the first service mesh was created, actually. And, well, of course, nowadays we have Kubernetes. And with Kubernetes, we have pods and we have containers. And instead of having an environment with just several services running and a proxy, now we can add the proxy next to each container. And because we are adding it next to each container, they are calling that a sidecar. So we now have proxy sidecars that we can just put next to each service we have. So now we have the sidecar proxy for each of our services. And here we can add all these functionalities we need. So this is how the second generation of service meshes was created.
Yeah, so that's interesting. So you can now put these cross-cutting concerns into a proxy, which will run in your sidecar container within the same pod within Kubernetes. And if you only have like 8 instances, you could still if you really want to configure those manually, because it's just configuring the proxy. But there are certain companies and certain they work on such a big scale. Let's take Netflix or Twitter or some other companies as an example. They are running like 400 and plus microservices. You don't want to configure 400 and plus proxies and configure the routes between the proxies. Configure timeouts for all the individual services. So this new pattern arose, which is the concept of a control plane. So what you see in more modern service mesh architectures is that the proxies themselves, they form the mesh, but there is something that will actually control the proxies. It will instruct the proxies on how to behave. It will help them discover the other instances of the proxies, and it will help with the security of the network. So in this control plane is is becoming a very important aspect within modern service-based architectures. And the control plane then will be the one who is responsible for most of the configuration for all these cross-cutting concerns. So it won't be like the single point in which you the single point of failure through which all the services will communicate, or through which all the proxies will communicate, but it will just be the puppet master, as to say. And to give you some examples of more modern proxy-based service meshes and these control planes, there are a couple of them. So there's, for instance, Istio, LinkRD. On AWS, you have AWS App Mesh, and you have, for instance, Console Connect. So it's getting this technology, or this trend is becoming much more popular these days, because lots and lots of people are actually moving towards microservice architectures and running on the Kubernetes environments. And some of these products are actually based upon, for instance, Kubernetes or a container-based platform. So it's interesting technology.
Yeah, nice. Can you give us an example of
Service mesh? So let's take a look at, I think Istio is one of the most popular ones. It's at least one of the service mesh and control planes that I hear the most about, especially at conferences. You see a lot of people from Google there. Google is one of the companies that are actually behind Istio, together with Lyft. And I'll share a little bit about why Lyft is also in there. And in this case, Istio, within our microservice architecture, is responsible for doing a proper connection, for authentication, authorization of the services, and also encryption of the layer, of the network layer, but also will allow us to configure the proxies or instruct the proxies for traffic management and policy control. So let's take a closer look at the architecture of Istio itself. So what we can see here in this diagram, this is architectural diagram from Istio. And at the top, we see our service mesh or our services with our proxies, and they're communicating. So we can do HTTP and HTTP2, gRPC and TCP traffic between these proxies. And to be able to actually instruct these proxies, we have the control plane. And within the control plane, and this really differs per service mesh product or technology, as you might say, this set of components differ. So this is just an Istio example, but I think it's good to show them. So when you want to interact or want to configure your service mesh, and you want to configure those services, in Istio you talk to Galley, and Galley is the service which is responsible for validating your configuration. So you will send a YAML file towards your towards Istio, towards Galley in this case, and it will parse the validation, see what needs to happen, and if it's valid, it will just send it along to Pilot, and Pilot is responsible for actually configuring your proxies. And next to that, we have an additional component, which is Citadel, and Citadel is actually responsible for doing the security of the network. So it will handle certificate management, and it will communicate that with different proxies on what needs to happen. And then last but not least, with Istio, we have Mixer. And Mixer is responsible, for instance, for telemetry and observability of your service mesh. And one, I think, very important aspect that needs to be mentioned, and I think that doesn't happen very often, is that Istio is just like the control plane, but it really depends on the proxy that you're actually using within this microservice, within this service mesh. And Envoy, which is originally developed at Lyft, is, I think, actually the real magic in this whole service mesh architecture. Because Envoy itself is responsible for the service discovery, so it needs to figure out, based on the service registry, where the other services are. It can actually do load balancing for you. It does the actual communication across the different layers, so HTTP, TCP. It does circuit breaking for you, so you can configure it just like any other proxy, but if there's a timeout, it needs to do some sort of action. And the interesting part is, because all the communication, all the network flows go through this proxy, it's developed to be a very lightweight, high-performant piece of software. And while you communicate, it will also gather lots and lots of statistics about what's going on in the network. So that's really interesting. So like I said, we had Pilot, and this is the thing that worried me a bit when I first saw some of the demos at these conferences about service meshes. I see somebody on a terminal, which I'm fine with, and I'm not really that bothered, then editing a whole bunch of YAML files with a whole bunch of configuration and options, and then just say, well, just do kubectl and send it towards my cluster, and then all this magic happens. And I wondered, so what's going on there? What's this magic? What's going on? So I looked at, for instance, Pilot in this case, and what Pilot does is Pilot's actually instructing the Envoy proxies. And it helps the Envoy proxies by sending it the configuration through a specific API that Envoy understands. So it actually abstracts away the proxy and the configuration layer and the APIs. So Istio, in this case, has its own definition language, and it will just translate that actually to the configuration that Envoy understands. One other interesting aspect was like, okay, so how does a proxy actually know how to find the other proxies? Envoy by itself, or Istio by itself, doesn't maintain a service registry. So it's just using the service registry of the underlying platform. So, and if you would install Istio on Kubernetes, which is, I think, where it's deployed on most of the time, it will just use the service registry of Kubernetes itself. So that's really nice. Again, it abstracts away the underlying layer of the of what it's running on, and that's where Pilot is responsible for. With regards to tracing, it's another abstraction. So tracing now happens on the proxies itself, so you could do it in still in your application, but on the proxies, if you send a request and it goes through the proxy, with tracing, what you actually do is create a sort of like a unique identifier for that specific request. You metadata it with some attributes, and when you send it along to a second service, that service will also retrieve these headers, and it will create this entire list of all the services this request has been through. And so that's interesting. So it will annotate these methods, and you will get these headers. But to actually be able to make sense of what's going on, you also want to have this information stored in a different system so you actually can analyze it later on. But you don't want to do this in real time on the proxy, because that would make the proxy quite a heavy piece of work, and it will have to do a lot of processing. You want to do this asynchronously. So there's no performance impact on gathering the tracing information. And if you want, you can actually plug, and this is where Mixer, for instance, comes in. Mixer has this concept of adapters, and Mixer again abstracts away the backend system. So you could say, well, I just want to gather tracing information, and Envoy and Istio will do that in a uniform manner, so it doesn't use any specific format for a specific backend. But Mixer with a certain adapter will actually transform that very uniform and generic information into a specific piece of information that, for instance, Zipkin or Jaeger understands. When I was looking into this, and I was like, okay, so what's going on? How can I figure out tracing? And do I just see them between the services, or do I also see them between the proxies? I took a look, and what you actually see, for instance, in this image, you see a bunch of services calling each other. So in this case, you see we have a product page, and product page will call a detail service, and it will also call a review service, and the review service will call a rating service. So there's a whole bunch of services involved. But you will also see some calls to Istio-specific services. So when, for instance, you apply a policy, and I'll touch upon it a little bit later on, the proxies will maintain like a local cache of all the policies within the network, or which the ones that are important to them. And sometimes it doesn't have that information, so it will look it up. So there could also be some overhead in that sense for figuring out what to do when a request comes in to one of those proxies. Same goes for telemetry. So we want to gather some statistics on what's going on in the network, how many requests are being handled, what's their average response time, what's their average latency. This is all gathered on the Envoy proxies by themselves, and they are stored in like a very minimalistic local cache. And then once in a while, Mixer will actually fetch this information from the proxies and actually store it in a proper backend so you can do analysis later on. And you could use, for instance, Prometheus for that, or Stackdriver, or any other piece. Again, for Mixer, you have this adapter model, so you could plug in your own backend, which is very interesting. And one of the things that I was wondering about, I have this huge passion for CI/CD. And with continuous delivery, I always like to know, well, is my serving behaving well if I roll out a new one? So sometimes I want to do a canary test, for instance. So I want to publish a new version of my service. Perhaps I rewrote it in a different language or used a different framework for it. Could be the same microservice. And I want to shift my traffic. So I want to say, well, I just want to send like 99% of my traffic to version 1.5, I think, in this case. And 1% to version 2. And then just see how version 2 behaves based on the metrics and the log information that I see. Now, if you would take a look at Kubernetes, for instance, if you use plain Kubernetes, this is not very easy to do. Because the only thing that you can actually do is just spin up 100 pods, because it will do round robin load balancing. And then you might hit like 1% to that one specific container or that one specific pod. And then see how your service behaves. But because we abstracted this away, and we're now using very smart proxies in that sense, the proxies can actually do some really interesting stuff. So they can be handled, this traffic shifting, it can be handled on the proxies themselves. And I think this makes it a very interesting and powerful concept. And this is just a simple example. You could even use like request headers, which are passed along through your service call chain, to do this advanced routing. Now, one other very important aspect, I think, is what Istio also tries to solve is having like a secure by default network. So if you would use a normal Kubernetes environment, then the connection between the different pods are not by default secure. And because we abstracted away this layer from the underlying platform, Kubernetes in this sense, what the Envoy proxies try to do is make this network secure by default. So what you can do, and this is also a piece of YAML configuration, is that you could actually say, well, I have this new mesh policy. So this is policy which is applied for my entire mesh, so not for a specific namespace or not for specific services. And it will run for the default namespace, and I will actually want to say, for all the peer connections that I have, I want to enable mutual TLS, and I don't specify anything specific, so it will account for all the services. Now, this is where you say, from the receiving end, so from the server, that you want to be able to do mutual TLS. So you also, to be able to actually get mutual TLS, you also have to do something on the clients. So here again, you will also say on the client, you specify a destination rule, which is like an outgoing rule. And in this case, you will also say, well, for the default, like this is going to be a default rule, and from the namespace is still system, which is the system namespace within Kubernetes. For the services that end with something .local, I will specify this traffic policy, and this traffic policy will be mutual TLS. So Istio mutual. Now that's interesting, And one of the other things that I found very interesting also is that you can do role-based access control. So you can actually specify, even on like HTTP headers, what services can call what other services, but also what they can do to those services, so what operations they can trigger. And I think this is very interesting to actually see, so you have to apply also, again, two rules for that. So you have a service role and service binding. But this makes it very interesting. It adds a lot of functionalities just on top of normal cross-cutting concerns that you have in your microservices.
Yeah, so, well, we've seen a lot of functionality that Istio can supply for us, and yeah, that's cool. But, well, yeah, it's we can all use this, but of course nothing comes for free. So you can imagine when you are adding Istio to your architecture, you will get all those proxy sidecars, and you get your control plane, and those are all extra resources you are going to add to your environment. And those extra resources will take some CPU and memory, and well, you have to be sure that you can handle it. So for example, if you are running Istio locally, you will quickly find out that it's actually taking quite some CPU and memory of your system. So, well, you have to be aware of these things. And also, when you have proxies between your services, this will also have some kind of latency in between, because, well, these proxies are in between. So you have to take care of that as well. Also, well, of course, a proxy can fail. So you have to be sure that you know how to figure out if there's a failing proxy. So you need to know how you can debug your proxies. And also, of course, these extra proxies need to be secure. If there's a vulnerability, you need to figure out how you can fix that. And, well, we can add a role-based access control, but all those rules you have to... when you have a lot of microservices, you need to be sure that you create a clear overview of what is possible and what is not. So these are all things you need to consider when you want to use Istio. And well, there are of course a lot of things you can do, but well, you really have to consider that the pros outweigh the cons. So, well, we saw an example of service meshes, and that was Istio. But of course, as we already had seen, there are also other service meshes available. So how do they compare to each other? Well, this is a table. It's actually already outdated, but it gives an overview of several service meshes available. Most of them are already sidecar proxy. But Linkerd, for example, is an old example of the first generation of service meshes. And well, they provide different things in case of functionality. And well, as I told you, it's already outdated. So that means, well, each of these service meshes are quickly evolving in better service meshes. So the functionalities are added and changed to better supply the functionality for your microservices. So, yeah, but the question is, do we really need a service mesh in this case?
Well, I think that's a very valid question. Because if you have like a microservice architecture and you want to... well, pull these cross-cutting concerns away from your applications, and you want to put them on a lower or higher level, depends on how you, on your perspective. You might really wonder, do I really need it? Is it something like the complexity? Do I really want to introduce that complexity and all the additional moving parts into my architecture? Well, one of the things I always see is like a lot of people go to a conference, they see this really nice talk about this, all this fancy, shiny technology. And they're like, yes, I really need that. I really need that. It will solve all my problems. So, and I think this is like This is not the right reason to actually want something like this. But there are some very valid reasons. And so let's take a couple of examples. For instance, mutual TLS between services is something which is not by default in Kubernetes. And if you would really want that, let's say you have a very big cluster with lots of different services, and you don't want anybody to snoop in on the network somehow, then having mutual TLS is a very interesting aspect because, in this case, Istio, or the service mesh technology, will provide this for you. They want this to be secure by default. So it's one of the concerns that you, well, might be interesting for you if you have a bigger architecture to move towards a service mesh technology. Another interesting aspect could be is that you want to introduce like or intercept some network flow and you want to do some advanced circuit breaking or A/B testing of your services. And if it's not provided by your existing container platform or another different solution in your architecture, it could be definitely a valid reason to look at a service mesh. And again, also, if you would have multiple services, maybe written in different languages, using different libraries, and you have lots and lots of teams working on different applications, and you want to still maintain traceability and visibility of your services, a service mesh could definitely be interesting to take a look at. But then I always wonder, now I have my application, and it already does these cross-cutting concerns. And then let's say I want to move over to a service mesh technology. Should I just remove my libraries?
Yeah, so that's a question. Can you just remove all your libraries? Well, let's take an example. For example, circuit breaking. So here we have a configuration file you can provide for Istio. So we have a destination rule for a specific service, namely the booking service. And, well, we have some connection over HTTP. But we are actually interested in the lower part of this rule. So here we define our circuit breaking configuration. So the first thing is we want to open the circuit. So you all remember the circuit breaker pattern. So you want to open the circuit at the moment more than one errors are coming back from the service we are trying to call within 1 second. At the moment that the circuit is opened, we are going to wait for 3 minutes until we are going to call the failing service again. Also, we are never going to call the service at the moment our circuit is opened. So we can also define an order, not a percentage, at the lower part, but so that we still try to connect to the failing service. But here we define a 100% ejection. So we are not going to call the service until we reach the timeout of 3 minutes. So this is an example of how you could implement circuit breaking into your code with the help of a library. So here we use Spring and Hystrix. And with Hystrix, we add an annotation on the method that will be calling our other service. And if this other service is failing, we will use a fallback method. And this fallback method will actually ensure that we still can give a valid response in this service. So here we are going to our cache repository, and that will have a valid response, even if the service that we wanted to call is failing. So this is something we can configure with our library, but we cannot do this with Istio. So this is a very specific case where you maybe actually want to use a library instead of Istio. Also, the tracing, well, we heard that the proxies will add the tracing identifiers to your service calls. But you have to be sure that those trace identifiers are actually passed also through your services themselves. Because if they aren't, then your services will not pass that information to your tracing system. So you have to get those header identifiers in your request and need to pass them to your tracing system.
Yeah, and also, if you add these headers, it will end up in your system and you can inspect them. But like if we have multiple microservices, so we go in this example that we saw in the beginning, we go from service A to service D all the way down, you will have to actually add those headers to the additional service call you're making. Because from your application logic, you'll actually be making the service call, but the proxy will actually handle the connection. So if you forget to add these headers in your consecutive request, your tracing will be broken. So it's not just that you can just like flip a switch and say, I want to have tracing for all my microservices. You still need to do something in your application logic itself.
Yeah. So as we were seeing, it's not just like adding a service mesh to your microservices system and that's just it. Or adding a library into your microservices system and that's just it. You still need to consider several things in what you want, what you have. And then you can make sure that everything is going to work just fine and that the communication is reliable. So, well, we found out what actually a service mesh is. So a service mesh is a dedicated infrastructure layer between your services that will help in the communication of those microservices.
So I think another important aspect that we hope you take along from this talk is that you understand why service mesh actually exists, what the original reasons were, and what problems people are trying to solve. Because I think that's interesting to take into account when you consider or when you watch your next presentation at a conference or online about the concept of a service mesh.
Yeah, and also, well, we found out that a service mesh can become quite complex, and but still, it also adds really good functionality for your microservices that you could actually use.
And so I think that the last thing I would like to give along, and I think this is always a general advice, but when you consider a new technology, for instance, like a service mesh, always think about the specific problems that you really try to solve. It's fun that there is this new thing that can solve all your problems magically, but really drill down on what your actual problem is and if it's really solving your problem or if that is just making your problems worse or more complex. So I think this sort of concludes our talk. I wonder if anybody's had any questions. I see. Yeah, so I'll just rephrase the question. So the question is, I already have an existing architecture with about 40 services. I can imagine that implementing Istio, for instance, could take some time. That's the answer is yes. It will probably take some time, mostly planning. What actually happens when you, for instance, install Istio on an existing service, you can just install it. But then for all your existing pods, you will have to inject the sidecar. So there's this process that can actually do that for you. So you might want to take a look at that. If you really want to have like all the benefits that you saw, like circuit breaking, mutual TLS, you will have to do some additional work because you really have to configure those. But it's definitely possible. There's really good documentation also about on like, if I run Kubernetes and I want to go use Istio, it's just an additional layer that you plug into your system. And Istio by itself is mostly the control plane, so all the different components. But it's mostly the sidecars that you really need to inject next to your existing pods. Good question. Any other questions? I see a question here.
Yeah. You mentioned about the chain calls. Mm-hmm.
Not to have
unidirectional connections. Mm-hmm. At least they can be semantical because you end up in a way communicating.
Yep.
But you reduce the logistical part of the two-way communication.
Mm-hmm.
Have you had any experience in such systems? It's because it adds overhead.
Mm-hmm. I haven't been in that scenario myself. What I do know is that like performance and latency and so on are the one of the big concerns everybody is having with introducing a system such as Istio, for instance. Like the communication between the service itself and the proxy, that's pretty straightforward because it just communicates on a local host, so there's very low latency overhead. Between the proxies themselves, it really depends also on the amount of traffic that you flow through those proxies or the complexity of the rules that you provide. So let's say we had some of those advanced routing rules or authorization rules. The more rules you add, the more evaluations it needs to do. So the latency will also become a bit higher in that sense because the service will become a little bit slower. From what I've seen, is that the people behind these communities who are actually working on the product itself, they're trying to address these issues. If you look at Istio, for instance, like a year ago, you will see that the architecture and the responsibilities of certain of these functionalities, they have moved away or they split it out into separate components to improve the overall performance of the mesh as a whole. And they started introducing like local caches for policy rules and so on. So there's a lot of activity going on to make that to really push down the overhead of those services and get the latency decrease the latency. Does that answer your question?
You actually rephrased my question.
Okay. Okay. Let's discuss afterwards. I think Let's see. I can okay. I see another question. Yep. Okay. Yeah. That's a very valid question. Do you want to answer it? Should I answer it? Okay, I'll take a stab at it. So you have your application, and if you run in a Kubernetes environment, you'll usually package your application inside a container. So when you deploy your application, the container is running, and the process within that container is your application in that sense. And these proxies, these sidecar, are sidecar containers, and a sidecar is a concept of Kubernetes. So if you have a pod in Kubernetes, which is a single unit of deployment, usually you'll have your application, which is the container. So you have your own service container within this pod. And with Istio, you actually inject an additional container within the same pod. And that's then, in that case, the sidecar. So that's the proxy. And what happens is if you start communicating, then based on IP tables and some firewall and routing rules, it will actually diverge the traffic from your application through the proxy and then connect to the different proxy. And then based there again, it will pick out the right service. So that's sort of where the sidecar lives. So it just lives in the pod. It's separate from your own application, which is also, of course, different from like using libraries because that's like overhead within your application. But the sidecar itself, is the proxy itself, is a separate process. Okay, I think that's it. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.